Okay, would you join me in welcoming to our class this morning, Dr. Simon Gathercole. Come on up, Simon. And I've been told you are to sit here because it's got a black top and you have on black shoes, and I'm supposed to sit here because this has a brown top and I have on brown shoes. Yes, someone pointed that out. And we have great love for him. Okay. I hope that you are ready for a marvelous next about 40 minutes or so. Simon Gathercole is a friend of this class. He's a friend of mine. He is a New Testament professor at Cambridge University in England. Now, a lot of y'all may not be that familiar with Cambridge. Think like the Texas Tech of Europe. Okay? It's an amazing, amazing school. Cambridge isn't quite the community that Lubbock is, if you're looking in terms of the town itself. But the school is really, really, really fantastic. And so I'm delighted to give you a chance to get to know Simon. I'm going to interview him, and I've got behind this three goals. One goal is for you to get to know him a little bit and get some interesting information that you may not get otherwise. A second goal is for you to be edified by some of his teaching and some of his insights that he has to offer us. And then a third goal is to get some of my questions answered, because he's on the spot and he's offered to be here, so I can get, like, this is like free tutelage for me. And we're not having to pay tuition or anything. So this is really, really a cool chance. So we're going to start. Simon, just be open. Talk as much as you want. I'll interrupt as need be. But I want first you to tell the class something about you. Just tell them a little bit about you. Your family, where you live, what your life would be like if you were not here as our guest this morning.
Mm. Thanks, Mark. Yeah, thanks everyone for having me, by the way. I'm married to Rosie, who is the mother of our two kids. It's not Mother's Day in the UK today, so she won't be getting presents, and I'm not. we had our Mother's Day in March, but my wife Rosie looks after our two kids. Martha, who is our 11-year-old daughter, and Freddie, who is our 9-year-old son. That's the family. I'm an elder at Eden Baptist Church in Cambridge, which is, I was saying to the Australian friend sitting next to me that our church is a big church in the UK. And on a Sunday morning, the congregation is about the size of the choir here. That's the sort of scale of things. I know everything is bigger in Texas.
Yeah. This is pretty much just a Texas thing. You get outside of Texas and it's all small.
Yeah. And it's a great privilege to serve as one of the lay elders there. I'm not a member of staff, but there are eight of us who are elders of the church there. And it's the church that I attended as a student, and which I've come back to now. I teach in Cambridge, and it's a wonderful blessing to be there.
All right, where did you grow up?
I grew up in a suburb of London, in Surrey, just to the southwest of London. My dad, who worked very hard to keep us all going, drove into London every day for an hour, which, you know, was a slog.
You're an academic. What were your parents? What did your parents do?
My dad left school at 14 and my mom left school at 16. My dad was eventually a successful businessman, but it started out as an electrician's apprentice and gradually moved to another company where he made his way up.
So with parents who left school in their early to mid-teenage years, did you grow up knowing that one day you would have your PhD and you would be a professor at one of the most prestigious universities in the world?
No, I didn't. I mean, like probably like most young boys, I didn't really think much about the next day, let alone the next sort of 10 years. But but no, I was the first person in my family to go to university. So
So first person in your family to go to university. We don't have a lot of people familiar with the university system in England, and it's got some distinctions from the U.S. Mm-hmm. So how did you decide which university to go to? Where did you go for what we call undergraduate?
I went to Cambridge as an undergraduate, and that was partly because some of the teachers that I had been one of my two main teachers in school. One had gone to Oxford, and one had gone to Cambridge. So in the school system in the UK, we specialise quite young. So at the age of about 15, you take what are called the GCSE exams, where you study maybe 10 subjects. All the kind of basic subjects like maths, science, English, and then you can choose some things, but you have to do the sort of basic things like maths, physics, chemistry, English, and so on. But you could have some choices, and so I chose Greek, Spanish, and Latin as my choices.
Okay, just to help us understand, how many of you in high school majored in Greek, Spanish, and Latin? Raise your hand. Okay, never mind.
But then you can in your last 2 years at high school in the UK, you drill down into you just choose three subjects. So your last 2 years in high school, you can specialise quite young. So in a sense, at the age of 15, you're making decisions that are going to affect your whole life, because you know if you choose to do some of the subjects that I chose to do, you can't then go on and be an engineer or a physicist or something. So so I chose Greek, Latin, and ancient history, which sort of didn't give me many options afterwards.
did you have a lot of dates in high school? I'm just curious how it would roll there compared to...
I'm just trying to think how many it was exactly.
That's enough said.
No. I didn't have any dates in high school.
When did you become a Christian?
I became a Christian in high school at the age of 13 or 14.
How did that come about?
Well, I was at boarding school. So I went to one of those old-fashioned schools where you can do Greek, Spanish, and Latin, and ancient history. Spanish isn't so popular in the UK as it is over here. So what we had a school chapel, but the school chapel was basically a sort of liberal Anglican setup. And I think our chaplain described himself as a Christian Buddhist.
So a Christian Buddhist?
Yeah, so we didn't get a great deal of sort of...
Was that a reference to his size? or his faith?
No, I think, I think he was...
Some might call me a Christian Buddhist on a certain day, but not by faith.
But we also had some people who got permission to come in, and every year we had a series of Lent addresses. During the Christian season of Lent, there would be a weekend where people would come in from outside and give presentations. And it was really during that series of Lenten addresses where I first heard the good news. I'd been taken along to the Christian Union by some friends. It's boarding schools, not a lot else to do. So I went initially along, even though I was an atheist. I kind of didn't, I went along because it was friendly. But then
Union is like our campus crusade or something. It's a
in a high school. Yeah, okay. Exactly. Yeah,
all right.
Yeah. So I went along, and that was really. I mean, I didn't really know anything about the gospel. I mean, I was an atheist, but I didn't really know what I didn't believe in. That was when I heard the basics, and I heard a talk about someone giving a talk on that famous verse, Revelation 3:20, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock," Jesus says, "and if anyone will listen to my voice and open the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me." And so that was the time when I really first heard. I mean, after a few of the talks, one of the talks in particular, I knew that Jesus was addressing me personally, and that I could follow him.
All right, yeah. I'm going to interrupt for a moment and talk about how the hand of God works in this. How many of you have a New International Version of the Bible, an NIV Bible? Okay. Y'all need to thank Simon, who is one of the translators of the NIV. Because when Jesus stood at the door and knocked, he invited him in. That's pretty incredible. All right, so here you are. You're a young boy. You major in Greek, Latin, and ancient history. You graduate from what we would call high school, mm-hmm. and you go to Cambridge. Mm-hmm. What was your study in Cambridge?
Well, like I say, I didn't have many options, having chosen Latin, Greek, and ancient history. So, surprise, surprise, I did classics.
Greek and initially. Latin.
Yeah, Greek and Latin, language and literature and history, linguistics, and yeah, those kind of things. So, that's what I did initially.
Explain to us the difference. If you were to go to an American university, Texas Tech just comes to mind. You would be required generally to take what we would consider, depending upon which college you were in, College of Engineering or College of Business or Arts and Sciences, there would be core courses you were required to take. Mm-hmm. But every class you go to, by and large, would be a lectured class or a smaller, perhaps seminar class, it might be called, where there may be 10 to 20 students, mm-hmm. and you do a paper or something like that. Mm. Explain the education system at Cambridge for us.
Yeah, sure. I mean, this is one of the oddities and peculiarities of the system. It's not a widespread British thing, but it's confined really to Oxford and Cambridge, where most of the teaching that you receive is one to one with one of the professors. So you do go to lectures, but they're not often very good, and so you end up usually not going to them.
Gee, I'm going to take Cicero this semester, so there's a weekly lecture on Cicero. It's not that type of a lecture system. It's one where the let's fast forward. You teach right now at Cambridge. Uh-huh,
yeah, yeah.
So you're one of these one-on-one professors.
Yeah, yeah.
So you might tell one of your students that's got you, hey, go hear this lecture or go research this, or how does that work?
Yeah, well, I mean, we do have lectures as well, but they're, for the students, a relatively minor aspect of what they do. The main thing that a student has to do is basically write, for example, in my Jesus and the Gospels course that I teach to first year students, people coming in who are Jews, Muslims, Christians, nothing at all. The first thing they'll do is I'll set them an essay. Go and write me an essay on the question: was Jesus a law observant Jew?
A law observant Jew?
Yeah.
Okay.
And so what they do is they come back a week later, the night before they send me their 3,000 word roughly essay, and the next day we spend an hour where I kind of interrogate them, sort of cross-examine them about this essay that they've written. So it's very much a sort of Socratic dialogue method of teaching.
And you meet with students one-on-one, and that's how they learn. And you assign them papers. Yeah. They write them. You get them the night before. Yeah. The next day you question them.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
That goes on for the whole term.
That goes on for their whole 3 years. Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Yeah. So you get your degree at Cambridge. Mm-hmm. Is your degree in something?
Well, my degree ended up being in theology, which sounds strange because I did my first 2 years in classics, and I just did the final year of theology, but that was my final year, so I ended up having a degree in theology. So,
from Cambridge?
Yeah.
And then what did you do next after that?
I then worked actually for a year as a research fellow at Tyndale House. I don't know if I ever told you this.
Peter Williams.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
I was working on a research project there.
What was your research project?
It was for a book that never got published, which was probably a good thing because I was making it up as I went along. but I was supposed to be writing part of a book with someone else who was a senior, who was a sort of established scholar. Thankfully, he never wrote his half. So that was all for the good in the end. Yes, but that was a great time of learning and sort of getting research skills and reading lots of texts that I hadn't read before. So,
Okay, yeah. So you do a year of research at Tyndall House, and where did you go from there?
I then moved to Durham University, which is up in the north of England, sort of quite near the Scottish border, because there was someone there I particularly wanted to study with. I wanted to go on and do research in Paul, on Paul's letters, and the probably the leading sort of expert on Paul's letters in Britain at the time was in Durham, so that was what took me up there.
And that was Dr. James Dunn?
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so you got your master's there?
Did yeah.
You, what
yeah.
about your doctorate? Where did you get your doctorate?
I stayed in Durham for the doctorate. So, yeah, I did a one-year sort of master's course, which was preparation for research in New Testament studies, which, I really needed because I'd only done a year of theology. So I had a lot of catching up to do. But then, yeah, after that, I started my PhD in New Testament.
So what did you do your paper on, your dissertation?
My dissertation was on the theme of boasting and justification in Paul. And what I really looked at was the way in which Paul understands justification by faith, and how that was similar and different from how other Jews at the time understood, non-Christian Jews, how they understood justification. So that was the main topic.
How many of you were in the Life Group Greek class that I taught in here for a while? A good bit of you. See, look at all of that.
Very
okay. All of you need to know that if you remember the class I taught on the DK words, D-I-K long E, DK words, how we sometimes translate them with the Latin root justification, and sometimes we translate them with the Germanic root of righteousness. And we did a whole class on that, if you recall. That whole class is because of Simon. I was having breakfast with him in Cambridge, and I said, okay, I've got this harebrained idea to teach this Life Group Greek class of just fun things we could get out of the Greek if we dug in a little bit. What would you think would be worth? And he is the one who said, well, you really ought to play with the DK words, and look at the way they're translated sometimes with the Latin root of use, justice, and sometimes with the Germanic root. So he's been responsible for a lot of things in this class, and I need to give him some credit for that. So thank you. So James Dunn, a very prominent author of Paul, you studied under him. Would you tell, first of all, when you study under a man like that, do you sort of become his protege in the sense that you adopt his views, you kind of become his next standard bearer in a relay race, he hands you the baton and you start running the same race course he has started? Or is there room for disagreement and for you to cut a different path? Mm-hmm. Explain that to us.
Well, I think actually too often it does happen that people go and study with a senior scholar and they feel like they feel under pressure to adopt the views. And some senior scholars sort of are a bit irresponsible in sort of imposing their views on students. And I think that happens in particular in the German system. It's sort of understood that you go and study with someone and you sort of fit in with their school of thought on a particular question. It's not quite the same in the British system, and in particular with Professor Dunn, to his great credit, he was someone who he actually hated it when people did just assume as the truth what who are too submissive, because he loves a good argument, and so he was a great model of a PhD supervisor, as someone who permitted students to plow their own course.
So, yeah. Where did you fall in line in terms of Professor Dunn?
Well, I fell in line in that we had a shared interest in Paul, and we shared a concern as well that it's important. I mean, Professor Dunn is a committed churchman, and so although he was quite happy to have people disagree with him, he still thought it was important. But if you criticised him, he didn't take it personally. if you criticize his views, I mean, not sort of criticizing his marriage. I didn't go in for that or anything. if you differed with him on a particular point of interpretation, he was very gracious about that. The main area, I suppose, we differed was that he's probably the person who's most associated with a school of thought in New Testament studies, which is called the New Perspective on Paul.
Okay, explain to the class New Perspective on Paul.
Yeah, the New Perspective on Paul is really a sort of new understanding of justification, where justification by faith is less about the individual standing before God, and much more about the cosmic dimension of God incorporating the Gentiles into his plan of salvation. And so he was one of the people in the 80s and 90s in particular who pushed the point that when Paul talks about justification by faith, what he's getting at primarily, I mean, there are other things as well, and it's not completely divorced from the question of the individual, but it's more about the inclusion of Gentiles within God's people.
All right, we're going to dig down into this for a moment. And so give us a passage of scripture that might be one that we would discuss in this regard.
Okay.
And we'll put it up for the...
So say, let's say Romans 3, 27 and 28.
All right.
And 29. Let's say 28 and 29.
Okay. Romans 3, clearly we've talked about it in this class before when we talked about the DK verbs. okay, let's see. 3:27.
Just 28 and 29 would be fine.
28 and 29. All right, yeah. Let me read it. And I'm sorry I don't have an NIV here. So just limp along with us for a moment. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. Or is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles also? Yes, of Gentiles also.
Yeah.
All right. Now, with that verse in front of us, tell us the distinctions between the new perspective on Paul's approach to this verse and what you would see.
Yeah, I mentioned this this verse in particular because it's one of the standard places that those who advocate the new perspective on Paul would go to, and so because you can see clearly there, is it up there? Yeah, so you can see clearly there that there is, it's not completely mad to say that justification is related to the theme of God including the Gentiles in the people of God, because justification is not by works of the law, which are limited to Jews, but justification is through faith, which is available to everyone. And so it's certainly true that there is a dimension of justification which is related to this point that is a great concern of Paul, that God has a mission for Gentile people, and that the covenant, the traditional covenant, is not something confined to the members of the people of Israel. So this is a classic place that people would point to if they went for this new perspective on Paul, to say, well, look, we've got here in verse 28, we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. What does that mean? Well, it means verse 29, that God is not the God of Jews only, but the God of Gentiles also. So that would be a sort of summary of the new perspective on Paul. So you want me to move on to some of the problems with that view?
Yeah, I want to make sure that we're all on the same page because we may have some visitors here who may not. Explain the word justify for a moment, because that's not a normal word we use in everyday conversation.
Yeah. So, I mean, you're a lawyer. You can probably explain better than I. But
I'll fix it if you mess it up.
But in an ancient court, I guess in some ways like a present court, you had a judge who was presiding over a contention between two parties. Let's say party A and party B. And so party A and party B were engaged in a dispute or a legal contention in which one would accuse the other, and the other would accuse, they would accuse each other. And if at the end, the judge would have to pronounce that one party was in the right and that the other party was in the wrong. And the party was in the wrong might well be the party that had made the false accusations. So they would then be, if say a party had pronounced made false accusations, they would be pronounced guilty. And so if those accusations that had been made were turned out to be false, then person A, who hadn't committed any particular crime, would be pronounced righteous, and that is justified. The judge would pronounce this innocent party as justified, in the right.
So justified in this sense, is it fair to say, is a declaration from God that we are on clear footing with him?
Yeah.
We have been declared not guilty or are just.
That's right, yeah. I mean, that's the miracle of the gospel, because as the flow of the argument in the first chapters of Romans have made clear, we are guilty. We are sinners. We are people who have disobeyed the will of the holy God, and that we're guilty before him. But through, just before this passage, what makes our justification possible is what happens in verses 21 to 26, the death of Christ in our place. And so on the basis of Christ's death for us, we have this miraculous verdict by this judge. This judge who is not sort of showing favoritism, this judge who's not corrupt and pronouncing people innocent for that reason, but a God who in perfect justice pronounces us as righteous, pronounces us as justified.
All right, so now with justified fresh in our brains, Paul writes, we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. Is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles also? The new perspective on Paul sees this as Paul explaining the inclusion of the Gentiles.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And now explain your perspective on it in contrast to that for us,
sure.
Please.
I guess it depends a lot on what you see as the primary point of justification. Is the primary point of justification God including the Gentiles into his covenant people? And that's where I would disagree with Professor Dunn. What I see as primary is actually what you've got just at the top of the screen there, in verse 26, where on the basis of what God has done in Christ, he pronounces people righteous in his sight, pronounces people as justified. Those who have faith in Jesus. So there is a kind of individual dimension to justification, and that's what's primary. But then Paul goes on to explore even more in chapter 4. One of the implications of that and the scope of that justification, once you've established what justification means, namely that God pronounces in the right those who previously were guilty, pronounces them in the right on the basis of what Christ has done. A significant implication of that and the scope of that is not confined to Jews, but is for Gentiles also. So that is the sort of secondary dimension of justification rather than the primary one.
So if we link this forward now, yesterday morning you and I had breakfast at Victor's Delicatessen on 1960. Oh my goodness. And I will also add that we believe Simon may have lost a pen that his father gave him 20 years ago there. So Charles, if you have a chance to run by with Simon maybe and dig in the booth where we were. In the process of that, I was talking to Simon about projects he's got coming up, a book he's just written on the atonement. And the subject came up of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And Paul references in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 the gospel. And this was important because I was talking to Simon about some what we would call non-biblical gospels that Simon is incredibly well studied in and well published in. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul says, now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preach to you, in which you stand, by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached. And then in verse 3, he says, here's the gospel. Here's what I delivered to you as first importance. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried, and he was raised on the third day, also in accordance with the scriptures. So that's the gospel in Paul. Mm. That's the good news, right?
Mm.
Now, is that good news tied closely to justification?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, what we have here, in particular in verse 3, is going back to what I was describing earlier as the miracle of the gospel, that Christ died for our sins. We sometimes sort of skip over the fact that someone is doing something very strange here. In the Old Testament and in our legal system, to some degree, people pay the penalty for their own sins. In the Old Testament, the standard pattern is you die for your own sins. King Zimri died for his own sins. The father of the daughters of Zelophehad. I was going to say the father of the daughters of Zelophehad. I could have just said Zelophehad. Zelophehad died for his own sins in the Old Testament. That's the standard pattern. So when we actually read a statement like Christ died for our sins, we should actually kind of wake up and think this is something extraordinary. And it's because Christ has paid the penalty for our sins that we are therefore no longer in our sins, that we are no longer guilty for our sins. And so it's on the basis of what Christ has done, having paid the penalty for our sins, that God can regard us as the ones in the right, as the ones who can be justified in his sight.
So the word gospel itself, our word gospel, is a nice Greek composite.
Mm.
Would you tell us about the Greek composite word so that we're on the same page as we look at this?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, in some ways, gospel is a mechanical translation of the Greek word euangelion. Gospel goes back to Old English, two words, God and spell, which means just good news. And euangelion, the Greek word, eu means sort of good or well, the adverb from good, well and good, and angelion, a message, as in an angel. An angel delivers a message, so angelion is a message. This Greek word here simply means good news.
Okay, so if the good news is that Jesus died for our sins, buried and raised in accordance with scriptures, how does that tie in by Paul into his Romans concept of justification?
Yeah. What we see Paul summarizing in 1 Corinthians 15 here is the good news. And of course, news means announcements. You know, when you watch the news on TV, it's an announcement of things happening, isn't it? And so that's what Paul says the gospel is. The good news is announcing the great events that God has done. That Christ has died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and appeared. So the good news is not so much Jesus loves me in my heart, but the good news is God has done these amazing things in Christ's death and resurrection.
Would it be fair to say that some Jews might view that as a shameful thing, in the sense that they should be able, and I'm talking about Jews in Paul's era, were there Jews that might view that in a shameful manner, the idea that they needed a sacrifice like that as opposed to their own good standing?
Yeah, I suppose when Paul was preaching, of course, the temple was still standing, and so many Jews assumed that the whole sacrificial system in the temple was working, and that they were in good standing with God, partly because of their own obedience, but also because of the sacrificial system dealing with sins. But Paul is actually saying that the problem is even deeper than that. The problem is even deeper than one which requires animal sacrifice. What we need is someone actually paying the penalty. Paying the penalty for sins, and the epistle to the Hebrews, of course, goes into this point in even more detail.
The reason I'm asking is because I want you to then help us with an earlier verse in Romans. Now that we understand what Paul means by gospel, that he's talking about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus on our behalf, this is an interesting verse now that takes on a big meaning. I'm not ashamed of the gospel.
Right. Yes. Yeah. I mean, sorry. I see what you're getting at now. Yeah. For many Jews, of course, the idea of their Messiah dying a shameful death in crucifixion is something that you jolly well ought to be ashamed of. You know, many of Paul's Jewish contemporaries would have said to him, you ought to be ashamed of proclaiming this blasphemy, the idea that that our Messiah might be subjected to this cruel and excruciating death on the cross, and so that makes it all the more remarkable that Paul makes it clear that he's not ashamed of this message. Yeah,
it's the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, Jew first, also the Greek, for in it the righteousness, and again this is a DK word, dikaios, I guess, the righteousness of God, the justification of God, is revealed from faith for faith. And we can discuss that in a moment, but the justified shall live by faith. How does, if we understand that the same word in the Greek that's the root of justified is being used here, how does all of that interplay? They put it to us in a package.
Say that again.
I don't think I
so
can.
Am I being a hostile witness?
Yeah. Permission to treat the witness as a hostile witness, Your Honor. No. It just seems to me that there's a great profundity, a great profoundness about Paul explaining that this good news is not a separate good news for the Gentiles.
Yeah.
It's not a separate good news for the Jews. It is the good news that's constant there for everyone in his day, in our day, in every day. There is a rightness in Jesus dying on our behalf, an atonement.
Yeah, this is obviously something very close to Paul's heart, of course, because he was the apostle to the Gentiles. And so that's why you do see the point emphasized quite a lot, that actually God is concerned with the Gentiles and not just with the Jews. A point that comes out even here in verse 16, to the Jew first, yes, but also to the Greek, idiomatic way of saying for the Gentiles. And so Paul is very emphatic about the fact that Jews and Christians are not Jews and Gentiles, sorry, are not saved in different ways. That there is. I mean, you do find some scholars coming up with this extraordinary idea that Jews are saved one way, but Gentiles are saved through Christ. Absolutely extraordinary idea that Israel's Messiah should not be the savior of Israel, but savior of someone else. And so, yeah, Paul is very emphatic about the point that the righteousness of God, the justifying act of God expressed in Christ, is the same good news for Jew and Gentile alike.
All right, so let me ask it this way. If it's the same for Jew and Gentile, as Paul's writing here, is it the same in terms of timing? Mm-hmm. Can we say the gospel is the basis of salvation for those who live before the cross of Christ as well as those who live after?
Yeah, absolutely. And this is a point that Paul develops, but not very much. It doesn't develop it a great deal because he's thinking more about the future and his mission and the believers in the present in his presence, this side of the Christ event. But there is one place in that passage that we just mentioned in Romans 3:21-26, where he talks about how the fact God has in the past, before Christ, shown great patience and restraint in not just sort of wiping out the human race, but there was a period of his forbearance during which he didn't simply punish everyone in full measure, didn't punish Israelites by just excluding them completely. But during this period of forbearance, sins were sort of piling up, as it were, and God has now in Christ dealt with those sins. Can we just pull up that passage? 3:25 and 26.
Starts here, 3:25, this was to show.
Yeah. So the great work of Christ, which is described just before that in the first half of verse 25 there, God presented Jesus so that his blood would atone. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance, his patience or restraint, he had passed over former sins. In other words, he hadn't simply wiped everyone out and sent people to divine condemnation to hell on the basis of their former sins. Now, God hadn't done that, so does that call into question whether God is really just? He's just passing over these sins. How can he do that and still be a holy and righteous God? Well, verse 26 provides the answer to that. God sent Jesus to die for sins to show the fact that he is righteous, to show his righteousness at the present time. So the previous time of patience and forbearance, present in recent present for Paul, Christ has died, so that God can do two things, show himself to be two things. On the one hand, a righteous and holy God who really does deal with sin, doesn't just pass over it forever. As we heard in the sermon just now, God doesn't just wink at sins and think, oh, well, never mind. He has shown that he is just, but also that he is the justifier. So God has found this miraculous way of both establishing his own righteousness and holiness and justice, and at the same time saving people. And that's what the death of Christ accomplishes.
And again, we've got the DK words here, righteousness and just, the same root in the Greek.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just we've translated it as two different words in English.
Yeah, it's because we don't really have a word. Well, we do have a word justice, but justice doesn't quite capture justice doesn't quite capture the saving activity of God.
All right. So God himself shows his own righteousness, dikaiosunes, I guess, mm-hmm. his righteousness, mm-hmm. even as he makes us righteous.
Yeah, yeah.
He shows his own justice even as he declares us just, because a just penalty was paid for the sins. Mm. It wasn't arbitrary.
Absolutely, yeah, yeah.
Okay. So you wrote a book on the atonement. Mm. Tell us how this ties in. Explain is this in your book? Is this...
I don't really go into justification in the book, but I do emphasize quite a lot the point of Christ dying as a substitute. And this theme of substitution, it's a sort of, in some ways, it's a bit of technical theological jargon, but on the other hand, any sports fan probably knows what substitution means, just one person taking the place of another. Unfortunately, what I've found as I've been studying as a student and as a lecturer now, is that the idea of Christ dying in our place as our substitute, that Christ bearing our sins instead of us, is actually a very unpopular idea among some scholars. It has a sort of nuance of unfairness, injustice, immorality, God punishing his son, God punishing his child, and so for many scholars, it has a sort of nasty taste to it, this idea of substitution. Doesn't really fit in with the Old Testament idea of God's righteousness. And so part of the reason why I wrote this book was to put substitution back on the scholarly agenda as a key theme in Paul.
Okay. Last word for us. We've got 2 minutes before we close. What are you working on? What's next?
One of the things I'm doing, for those of you who were at the lecture last night, I'm doing a very, very short little book on the place names in the Gospels, showing how the place names in the Gospels and the geography of the Gospels is supported by external evidence. And so it's a kind of a little apologetic book, really, on how the geography of the Gospels helps to show the claims to the authenticity of the Gospels, their historical reliability. But that's a smaller project. The larger thing I'm doing, Mark mentioned that I've done some work on the Gospels outside of the Bible. So I've written my most recent book on that was a commentary on the Gospel of Thomas. So if any of you are ever preaching or leading Bible studies on the Gospel of Thomas, then do consult my commentary. That was supposed to be a joke, sorry.
That British wit. Whoa, boy. That's from an old Benny Hill skit, isn't it?
So yeah, I've written three books in the last sort of 10 years or so on apocryphal
this
gospels.
Is on the internet. You might want to go ahead and make clear that you don't see the Gospel of Thomas canonical.
Yeah. That's right. The Gospel of Thomas isn't written by Thomas, and it's not a gospel really either, in the sense of having the true saving message of Christ.
Hence why it was a joke if you preach on it. Go ahead.
One of the main thing I'm doing now is a theological comparison of canonical gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, with other gospels like the Gospel of Thomas, the Gospel of Judas, the Gospel of Philip, and so on, really using that process to elucidate what the saving message presented in each of those gospels is.
Fantastic. Okay. We are out of time. Normally, I would bless the class before they leave, but would you say a word of blessing over us, please?
Sure. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of studying the scriptures in which is contained the treasure of the gospel. And Lord, we pray that like Paul, we would not be ashamed of it, either in our own lives, with our families, and with unbelievers as well, but we'll be bold in proclaiming it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.